the start of my project. I chose to do a tiny house because I'm kind of obsessed with them and the whole like culture around it. And when I was a kid, I always used to draw houses and floor plans. I was excited to get to do my own project, like on my own terms like that. And I'm kind of studying the theory of phenomenology, which I'll get into on the next slide, along with the thesis. And I'm also trying to convince you guys, the audience, that a common argument against tiny houses is that they're very similar to RVs and campers. Like, people often argue, well, why don't I just buy a camper instead of a tiny house? And because they're usually cheaper and easier to deal with. But I'm hoping that I can convince you that they're very different and tiny houses are better. So I'm looking at the theory of phenomenology, which is specifically the importance of craft in this project. So in the past, architecture used to be considered more beautiful because things were handmade and more carefully thought out, like structural connections and details and everything, which is definitely something the tiny house movement employs. And then also related to phenomenology is the connection between the built and natural environment. So I'm really trying to create a strong connection to nature with this house. So some preliminary goals I had with the project was one, to create a completely off-the-grid tiny house. Two, to design as many things in detail as I could. The furniture, everything in the interior. Three, to study the structure and the building systems and how everything works and be able to figure it out on my own. And then four, to create a building with a unique identity. So these are some words that kind of describe tiny houses. Generally, they're less than 500 square feet, usually on wheels, so on a trailer. And the tiny house movement has grown alongside the green building movement, so a lot of the houses are off the grid or have sustainable design strategies. And they're also designed customized to their owner. So those are all things that influence my design. And these images, the top one is Henry David Thoreau's house on Walden Pond, which is kind of considered the first tiny house. Like, he lived in there for 2 years and in a one-room cabin. And some people also consider the primitive hut to be the first tiny house. So some interesting facts that I found early on in my research. These diagrams kind of show comparisons between traditional houses and tiny houses. So the average cost of a normal size house in America is $272,000 versus a tiny house, which is $23,000. And that directly relates to the size of the house. So average size of a U.S. house is 2,600 square feet, which you can see in this image. This is 1975 to 2014, how the American size homes have grown. And then to the right of that is comparing to Japan, UK, and China, average size houses right now. So America definitely has a housing problem. We don't need this much space. And you can see in the chart on the top right that the average household size is decreasing. And then as people our age, millennials, my age, are looking to buy new houses, they're not looking for all this space that the older generations desire. So we're not looking to spend as much money on mortgages and don't feel the need for all the rooms. So there's the benefits of having a tiny house. Like I said before, they're mobile, so you can travel across the country. And because of that, there's a reduced carbon footprint. You're not putting a foundation You have lower taxes and little to no debt because they're so cheap to build. And you can really self-sustain yourself. And then environmentally, bigger picture stuff, a lot of tiny houses are able to be made out of completely recycled material. So I've seen ones that were built for under $1,000 with free or very cheap materials. And you kind of use, because the space is so small, you use a lot less energy and fuel, which makes a significant impact on the environment. So this is looking at spaces that are found in a traditional size home. And you can see, we have like living room, dining room, kitchen, multiple bedrooms and bathrooms, laundry rooms, and in a tiny house, things are seen more as spaces rather than rooms. So a living space, a sleeping space, and everything is all kind of open and together. And just looking for a comparison, the average size of a master bedroom is about the size of an average tiny house. So I had to pick a client for this house to kind of give it individuality, character. So I chose myself and my boyfriend, and so you'll kind of see the certain requests that we both have inside the house. Like we would both be a traveling architect and accountant. He loves to cook, so there's a big focus on the kitchen, and I love to create art, so I have certain aspects in the house that allow me to do that.
Did you go through a full programming exercise?
Yes, a lot more. I went through a very rigorous process, and it was hard to take out stuff, but there was a lot of background on every single decision.
Okay.
So this map is showing existing tiny house communities in the United States right now that you can travel to. Some of them you have to rent a space and you might not get an opening. Others allow you to come and go more easily. And then the maps on the right are other options. The top one being farms and wineries that allow you to park your tiny house at. And then the bottom map is people offering up like their backyards or land. So there's plenty of options. It's definitely doable, and it's a really growing movement. So more and more are popping up.
Nothing in Connecticut yet.
No, but there are people starting it. I joined this Facebook group this semester that they're talking about starting one very soon, and they've been meeting about it, so it's coming. So related to traveling cross country, these are the maximum dimensions that you can take the tiny house on the road with. So that's kind of the what I was using as a original basis to design my house. So can't be wider than 8.5 feet, can't be taller than 13.5, and that's including the wheels. And then it can be up to 40 feet long and then 60 feet with the vehicle that's towing it. And these are sustainable design strategies that I thought about early on before designing, and that I knew I wanted to employ in my design. So a couple of them are like insulated glazing, cross ventilation, using SIPs, which are structural insulated panels that will allow for thinner walls in the house. Having a water collection system, photovoltaic panels, a composting toilet. And energy efficient appliances. So then I took one more look at what my goals and how I wanted to approach the design process would be. So I had some conversations with people about having a strong connection to nature, and also how can we define the tiny house community, because if everyone's on wheels, like, how do you create this new type of community? And so far I've found that a lot of it is really digital. People talk to each other online and will meet up or discuss different ways they've built their home. So it's like a completely new type of movement. And we've also talked about maybe in the future there could be towers created that you can park your tiny house in and make it work in the city rather than sprawled out on the land. So these are a couple of precedents that I was looking at. I really liked buildings that had movable parts that could allow the design or the building to change. Because I just really wanted something, because it was so small, there had to be something really special about it. I think an element of surprise was the way to do that. Precedent from the way beginning was a Swiss Army knife, so how they get really compact and all the pieces pull out and have multiple uses. So this was the first phase of design. Like I said, it was a very rigorous process. Because my project's so small, I wanted to really exhaust all the ideas I had before I got to a final one. So first I came up with those models on the table right there, which were all different types of, inspired by different types of movement. So I came up with six conceptual names for each house, and they all are a different style tiny house, so this was kind of my jumping off point. This one would be a modular form that could, the walls could be taken apart, you could stack them on each other. The second one would allow you to kind of move the forms around depending on how you wanted to set up the space. The third one would allow you to attach two tiny houses together, and the walls would kind of flip up and allow for connections to the other buildings in nature. And these were all kind of based off of different personality types too. So like this one I was seeing as a very easy to maintain tiny house for like a traveling nurse or something. And then this one I was seeing as like a performer or pop-up shop where an entire wall would open up and allow the public to come to the building. And finally the sixth one was this little tiny compact one for the most nomadic of people. So then in the second phase of design, I kind of took all those ideas and started combining them. So I first looked at taking volumetric spaces and having those volumes really expand the building, and then push back inside after when you're traveling. So once you arrive at the destination, you can really expand the building. So I looked at volumetric cubes as well as folding panel walls, and I came up with two designs. So this one you can see the compact building, and then as it can slowly expand as the walls all fold out or push out of the building. The problem I had with this was it's hard to inhabit that building when it's all closed up. You can't get past the walls. But I really like the expansion part because it allowed for more rainwater collection and sunlight collection, so it made those aspects more plausible. And I also looked at another idea where the walls would fold out and allow for expanded space or air circulation or light. And then the third phase of design, which is very similar to my final concept, was again taking a really compact space and then expanding the building by rotating one corner. This was another exploration model with a similar concept where the space expands but by horizontal movement, so the walls pull out and fold up and down and really expand the building. And then I got to this idea. So there's a bunch of different kinetic parts that really transform the building and allow it to sit in different locations and relate to the context in different ways. You have like walls that fold down and create decks, walls that open up and create windows, and then the building rotation itself expanding the entire space and then allowing that space to be enclosed by a sliding glass wall and a roof that would slide over it. And those are some plans and sections of that idea, the building closed versus open. And then in the section, you can see the loft space that has plenty of headroom to be able to sit up in the bed, which was important. And then you can see under the trailer is my first ideas of where the water, rainwater collection storage would be located. And then this was just highlighting the sustainable design strategies that I introduced before, where they would be located in the house. And this is highlighting the kinetic parts of the building and showing that I was inspired by Olson Kunde, who does a lot of kinetic architecture. This is a kind of close-up of what the trailer would look like. So you have the trailer structure, which I kind of modified myself to make it work for my building, then the water collection in between the structure, and then the plumbing running within that. And these are some renderings that I had created of that building. So this is looking at it in a city context, pretty close up. This is looking at it on a mountain, but with the glass wall folded out to protect from wind. And then on a beach setting, so the house completely opened up. A lot of air coming through the building. And then the final design, I chose to stick with that same concept. And first started really looking into the details of how all these things work. So I was looking at how each kinetic part would work. I don't have them fully resolved, but I at least have an idea of how they each would work because there's so many of them. So this is looking at, again, the plan, open versus closed, and this is on the first level of that being the walk level. So the way you would enter the building is on this deck that would fold out, and then you'd be in the kitchen space. There would be a connecting living area right here where the glass walls are, or no walls. And then the bathroom with the loft above. And when the building's closed up and you don't want to deal with moving this, pulling that deck down, there's an alternate entrance right there with stairs that pull out of the house. And then these are some more developed sections. So looking at the loft construction, I lowered the bed into the floor structure, which allowed for more headroom than I had previously. And then there's also storage compartments that lift up. And
those happen in between the rafters? In between the beams, if you will?
The beams would be right here.
Yes.
So it would be its own separate structure to kind of allow for more storage. And, so these are some diagrams that I created for showing the structure of the building. And this one I thought about adding cross bracing for when the building's moving to kind of help stabilize it. If you're on a bumpy road, like, you're going to need some extra support. So those would kind of clip in when you're ready to move. And then showing the water collection, the sloping roof would collect the water into drains, and then the water would be stored in this half of the trailer. And then the other half would be for wastewater to be collected back into. I guess you can see the diagrams more clearly over there. So the next one is the plumbing systems and how they would work, and then the rent diagrams are all the different electrical systems in each space. So starting with the photovoltaic panels on the roof and where the energy would be stored and then distributed throughout the house. And this was a study on the rainwater collection itself and trying to see realistically if it could actually work. And you can see when the house is closed, the blue states are the ones that you can live in and have enough water that's collected each month versus fully expanding the house. You can collect much more rainwater and realistically live in the house. These diagrams are highlighting some of the interior moving parts. So we have a sliding bathroom door that covers a fireplace when it's not in use. And the fireplace would be electric and have the ability to heat the house. This couch and dining table has a multi-purpose, so the side of the couch flips up and turns into the table and allows the chairs to separate. And then I have counter space that can fold up right here that allows for either desk space or expanding kitchen space. The kitchen cabinet that slides down and then moves back up to be out of the way and allow for the view. I have easels right here that raise and lower to work on art. And then these chairs that you see outside are stored between the rafters and the kitchen. And this again is a kinetic diagram showing the exterior moving parts. And then this is looking at some of the details that I would be using. So in the entry deck, looking at bolted connections that would allow the structure to connect to one another and connect to the deck, and the columns that would be at the structure would have moving pieces that allow to just adjust the different ground heights. And I have these built-in planters by the entry that the panels kind of fold out of the wall and fold back in when you're traveling, and that's located close by the kitchen, so it's easy to access. So I have these windows that open up and allow light into the kitchen, and which is especially helpful when the building's really closed off. It allows a lot of light into the space. And then below that is a bar top area that opens up outside so you can sit outside. And that also expands the space into nature. And then sliding glass walls that are hidden next to the bedroom and then slide out, and a roof above the kitchen would slide over that and close the space. And this is showing like how some of the interior details would work. Like a desk I designed at the edge of the bed that would lower into that storage space that I mentioned before. These are all renderings that I looked at in different types of contexts. So this would be more in an urban setting, the house close up. And then this is looking from the kitchen counter towards the loft in the bedroom. And then this is looking at the loft. I have this window that uses smart glass that can turn from transparent to opaque with the flip of a switch, so you can get privacy along the bathroom better when you need it, but then also have a really open space.
What's the ceiling height?
So in this space, it's 2'9" on one end and then 3'3" on the other end. I measured my boyfriend and he was three feet sitting up, so he could fit in there.
From the floor to the ceiling?
Yeah.
So you can't stand?
No, you can't stand. Which is...
Which tall is it?
So this is looking at it in a forest setting, with the house expanded a bit, and then having this glass wall completely open, so the glass is hidden away. And then you can see like the bar seating right there, and you can easily just step back up into the house. And then this is looking at putting it on a mountain. So it's similar to some renderings I previously showed where the glass would be enclosed to protect from the wind and in this case the rain. And you can see that like how much the building rotation really helps enlarge a space and create a really nice living space. And then finally I have a beach setting. So this is looking at the bathroom out the house. There's no walls. And then for the bedroom, which is right above the last view, also looking out. And then finally the back view of the house. So here's the steps that I mentioned previously that you could get into the bathroom area. And then this deck structure that also has a sliding canopy that would allow for shade. And then I said easy access to the planters from the kitchen. So I guess I'll talk about my model next. In relation to those renderings, so these plans and sections that line up with the renderings are what they would look like in each context. So this is what the building would look like in the urban setting, really as small as it can get, and you can start opening up part of these glass walls to see inside and what it might, and then slide into this space right here and slide out, and you can use either one of the walls or both of them, and then there's a roof that is above the kitchen that would slide out to cover that.
So how does the glass wall get incorporated, or how is it?
Sorry.
Is
so there's this
already preset in?
Yeah. I didn't want this to get stuck in here when I was presenting, but
so that would just slide out.
Yeah. And essentially bolt it.
How about the return?
So I would see it as like folding into this one and then bolt slide. Looking at this deck structure, I would see this, sorry, this is kind of
tiny base.
So this wall would be pulled it up, somehow these structures would be pinned in place, and then you would physically remove the vertical structure, pin it into the deck. And this would be resting on the ground, because this part would be sitting above the ground, and then
that's it.
I hope I got all of it.
So how do you handle the plumbing moving in your kitchen?
I tried to make all the plumbing from the kitchen and the bathroom sort of end right in this area, so that when you turn the corner, you can snap on other pieces. Hopefully that would be realistic.
Well, I feel like I'm on the jury of Shark Tank. You know that show?
Yeah.
You've once again put your passion for what you were trying to accomplish into full use in high gear. And I've reviewed now three of your projects. I think that's just a coincidence, but you really, really pulled out all the stops, and it really is remarkable. Such a remarkable exploration of your idea that it's. We could get into criticisms about form and all of that, but I think before all of that, it just bears mentioning that this is just a remarkable, remarkable exploration and passion for what you have tried to accomplish. So, bravo.
Thank you.
Promised us that you would convince us that the tiny house is different than the air street.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so.
So how do you see that concluding?
Yeah, so traditionally, like, trailers and RVs are made out of really cheaper materials, are not insulated. It's definitely difficult to live in year round in one of those, but when you look at like all of the different design elements that really make this a home rather than a generic trailer, which is designed for anyone, you can have the same trailer manufactured and have tons of different clients, but I hope that this building itself has an identity that kind of reflects what I wanted out of the house specifically for me, and having more nicer materials and definitely creating an identity out of the building helps differentiate it from an RV.
I mean, I think an RV is an RV, kind of a metaphor.
Some of them do,
architectural metaphor.
So I tried.
Yeah, I'm saying that an RV is just more manufactured, where this is customized. use really kind of client release, and it's created, and the client just says, yes, that's the right thing for me, and they kind of buy it. So to me, that's the big difference between
You did explain it in class that this is depending on legality of an RV. So you want to explain that?
So actually, this weekend I came across there was an international building code created specifically for tiny houses last month. So people are trying to really employ that in their states right now. And so they've finally come out with their own code. Previously, people were building tiny houses based on RV codes to allow them to be legally built. But now they're pushing to have their own type of codes that the RV code kind of restricted you in some ways.
The part that's missing for me is the is when you talk about the difference and that this is personalized to you and those differences between, let's say, a tiny mobile home and what you have here is that your passion for art and your other client being your boyfriend who's an accountant, a traveling, an itinerant accountant. I think that the idea that what makes this, I mean, you said you had pull down easels. Now that you could have really taken the idea, and I'm not sure how you would have done that, but I'm sure you could have figured that out about what does it mean as a tiny house for an artist living with an accountant? And what are the architectural ramifications of that, of the particular program around the life of an accountant and the life of an artist?
So there's a couple of different ways you could
present. I mean, I'm not asking for an answer.
Yeah. I mean, I did kind of consider, him being an architect, providing him with working space for that. So I have the counters that pull out next to the kitchen that you could sit at and work at, and then the desk that pulls out above the bed or at the foot of the bed. So, I mean, those were kind of influenced by like the working.
But as an international itinerant accountant, perhaps the ability to tap into global markets from wherever you are in the world to, you know, be a satellite, or you being able to access any art museum and live with any work of art on a wall that you chose, because so many art museums catalogs are now digital. So I'm just sort of feeding off of your ideas about art and accounting.
I mean, he definitely is more interested in cooking than accounting.
Okay, all right. Fair enough. Well, it does look like a little bit of a food cart. I mean, it does have the idea of a food cart as well.
Yeah.
That should be part of the emotional part.
So, I have a question. So you started out saying that the wider the building is, when it's narrow, is 8'6". But you have a lot of these pop-up features.
Yeah.
So what is the wall thickness end up having to be? So,
So, I mean, it's kind of different in different parts of the building. It can get most. The wall thickness ended up being 4 inches. I was able to find these step panels that were really thin, and I kind of integrated, like, with this fold-out deck, this would be the panel itself, so that would completely fold out, but when it's folded into the wall, like, it
plus, you know, like, so
past the 8'6".
Because you have the one wall where it pulls it out, would that be a thicker, so would you?
So, yeah, like the sliding glass wall.
That would,
so there's an extra 6 inches right here, like an extra wall added, and then, so yeah, like that one is a lot thicker than the rest.
What would the ceiling height be on the lower floor? I guess back
but we figure, like, my boyfriend's 6'2", so as long as he can fit under it, like, it would be okay for us. And that also allowed for more headroom in the bedroom.
More headroom is in public space, a lot, from what you described. What's the exterior material?
I was thinking like a metal panel system.
And the basic frame is steel.
Yeah, I think earlier, I think part of your schematic design, I think there was this sort of realness that I was looking for you to sort of explore. You know, one is that you had sort of natural inclinations to say, hey, I like this draft, I like what it does, I'm going to infuse some craftiness. I don't see it like as far as a detailed perspective, but I do see it sort of in a big picture, small house perspective where things are moving and parts are shifting. Now you're a tiny woman with a small house. How much effort is it going to take you to move half of your building if some of the structure is actually steel? You know, are there actual pneumatic devices? Are there strings or pulleys and things that, again, start to recall some of the craftsness, but make things easier for this building to transform?
Yeah, I mean, one thing that I kind of added that I think would make things easier for this location, it's not in the model, but there would be a pop-out wheel on the bottom, kind of like an airplane wheel, so it would retract into the floor when you're not using it, and then that would help roll it out into the angle. It definitely would be difficult to hit some of these parts, like as one person, but I think with two, it's definitely reasonable.
I think that's what I was expecting since your last presentation that I had seen, is the actual mechanics of this. I was hoping to see how this really, how you figured this to work, how fair all this lines are going off. Just without having to take off the two or stop the two, was there like a quick pop-up device? Was there a way that you figured it out to engineer this? Because I don't want to just be sold on the pretty picture of how it looks inside. Because this is such a jewel box in a Swiss watch, it'd be nice to figure out how you've engineered this to really work in the way that you're imagining it. So that's what I was hoping to see next, because I kind of saw this from the last presentation, and then I want to be convinced on how this really slides, what you're going to track, how this is, and you know, it could easily just slide out this way, created kind of vestibule, but you've got this, which I like. I would love to know how really with the glazing to come out and set itself. You know, how you really truly work out the build and how you pitch it. Like why isn't it fixed on the side where the bed is? You don't have the best room. You don't have to worry about this kind of sliding, piping, plumbing. What does it have to be in the space to come to make it sound? So those are the real things I have to see how you approach this. Have you thought about coming up here again? Is there a ladder utilize every little bit, every little square foot of this building. Can all these start to unfold, and just really take advantage of this photovoltaic and so we start to really decline this sort of mechanical robotics. It adds more hardware, it adds more weight, I think it'd be nice to see also a large floor plan that shows the mechanics of how these things. It's like the Kundig drawings that are just hand drawn, and it shows you mechanically what he's doing to elevate these walls and upward these panels. would do you a lot of good to have that.
I mean, I intended to get there, but the farthest I got was really starting to diagram how, like, what I would use in each of those.
I think those are great. Like, I thought that was the beginning. That box, what you're not showing is how that box slides out. But it was almost, that's what I was thought you were starting to do.
Yeah, I mean, I know it definitely crossed my mind about how difficult it would be to kind of have the plumbing moving, but every time I tried configuring the building so the kitchen was in this space, I wasn't liking it at all. It was too cramped, and I really liked how to really open up this space right here and not really have, like, your kitchen in your bedroom, too. So that's kind of why I was that decision.
I think your drawings are, like, well advanced for, you know, thinking and fleshing out a lot of ideas. I think the next step for this would be, A, you're doing construction documents, you're doing a lot of plumbing systems, and you have to look at really sort of how things should really operate. And the next thing would be asking mom and dad to do money.
You don't need to ask mom and dad. You go to someplace like Westchester Modular Houses. They're looking for some reason. There's some Scandinavian modular companies that are out there doing stuff like this. One of the ideas you can think about for your plumbing is that there's no reason why the sink, if you're using a compostable toilet, the sink in the bathroom doesn't need to be connected to the rest of the plumbing. You can use a storage tank, you know, use one specifically for the sink in the bathtub so that it doesn't actually, and it goes through the compostable toilet. So you can make a connection in that way, potentially. So therefore, there's an assumption that you're plumbing everywhere, and that's not necessarily what you need to do here, given the compostable toilet component. So it's a, think more, you know,